This is the challenge that we face, to stay engaged every day with clarifying truth. And it's a big challenge, and I'm doing my best here to, you know, do my part. And it's not easy, to say the least. Today's a day of, you know, where nothing seems to go right. In fact, losing my patience, getting very frustrated. I can understand very well those in the world right now who are just feeling desperate. But let me say this. It's really because we're succeeding incredibly well. And there's some sort of thing about survivor's guilt. You know, when you succeed and everybody else is failing, it's very frustrating because you want to bring them along with you so that you don't feel this, you know, survivor's guilt syndrome of, oh, I'm free of guilt, but nobody else is. You know, so I feel terribly guilty to be free of guilt and no one else is. So you try to do the best you can to help others stay engaged with stay engaged every day with clarifying truth, but it just doesn't seem to get anywhere. It really doesn't. So we just have to keep our pedal to the metal and try not to get too frustrated. I know it's today was just one of the worst days ever for frustration, but it's because I believe of tremendous success. So what are we going to do? We're going to stay engaged every day with clarifying truth. One of the ways that I've done this is to look at this book called Spaciousness. It's actually, this is how the book looks, Spaciousness. And the title is The Radical Dzogchen of the Vajra Heart, translated by Keith Dalman, Longchenpa's Precious Treasury of the Dharma Datu. Whatever that means, right? So, this is the book we have right here, and Spaciousness, the Radical Dzogchen of the Vajra Heart. Now, why would we even look at such a book? Is the question. Why do we even look at such a book? What's in this such a book? Well, actually, it's pretty amazing. We have, in this book, we have a teaching which the, you know, highest adepts of in Tibet, the Tibetan adepts, would feel extremely fortunate to have. Okay. That is, and how we manage to have this in our hands today, you'd have to say it's a miracle. I mean, it's quite astonishing. This teaching comes from this great teacher and writer and someone who was able to sum up all the wisdom in a very clear way and bring it all together, named Longchenpa. This is a shorthand way of referring to his name, Longchenpa. Now, this icon on the right of this slide here is a stylized line drawing of Longchenpa that I use some photoshopping and vectorizing, etc., to get it like this. And it gives a wonderful, for me, it gives a wonderful kind of, radiates this pristine, formless, genderless, clear light quality of pure spaciousness, and this sort of this you know, eternal youthfulness there. And so sometimes just looking at this icon delivers a powerful spiritual transmission. So I put together this little slide as a background here, and in combining you know, several elements here, that this is actually the mountains of Tibet by Nicholas Roerich, a painting by Nicholas Roerich in the background. So this Longchenpa was a teacher. I say is a teacher, because he's still present, helping us out. This is what I've come to find out. And we have this incredible book translated by Keith Dowman, who did an inspired job, I'd have to say. You know, not have to, I'm pleased to say that the translation is quite inspired. Now, of course, no translation is going to please everyone, and there you're going to nitpick and find, well, can it say it this way or that way? But overall, I think taken as a whole, it's very inspired. And we now have the same teaching that the adepts in these, you know, caves and monasteries in Tibet, who are turning their bodies into, you know, light, and this is what they had. So we're fortunate. Aren't we fortunate? Now, where did this come from? Where did this teaching come from? It came from, there's a transmission you traced back to someone called, a teacher called Garab, G-A-R-A-B, Garab Dorje, D-O-R-J-E, Garab Dorje, coming from, they think, the Swat Valley of Pakistan. And he apparently got it, a direct mind transmission from a divine source, you would say. And this teaching has been passed on and elaborated upon and etc. And Longchenpa put it all together in a very, very clear, beautifully clear way. And what does it actually say? What is this teaching of Longchenpa's actually say, or the teaching that he clarified and helped pass on and make available? Well, it really deals with healed perception. It really deals with healed perception. And as I say, healed perception is the only issue we have. This is the only aim. That's all we have to do, is accept healed perception. That's all we have to do, which really means just setting down our wish that reality be flawed. That's all that it means, is we simply relinquish our foolish, whimsical, idle wish that reality be flawed. We simply relinquish that. Now, in terms of survival guilt, you know, how much more guilty would we feel if we don't set aside our idle, foolish wish to believe that reality is flawed? If we don't set it aside, and we don't experience healed perception, and we don't help anyone, and we only compound things and make it worse, how much more guilt will we feel then, right? So, of course, accepting healed perception will certainly lessen the guilt that we feel in relation to you know, those who are still stuck, because at least we're giving them hope, we're showing them the way, and so it's a much better option to go ahead and accept healed perception. So, really, the only topic of spiritual discussion is healed perception. No matter how you want to talk about it, no matter what words you use, no matter what teachers are teaching, they're all teaching healed perception. They're all teaching about healed perception. This is a great teacher who knew all about healed perception, who had healed perception in this world, and saw that there was no flaw whatsoever. And this is somebody who actually lived in many of our lifetimes here. So it is possible to have healed perception. It absolutely is possible to have healed perception and be in this world, okay, and function here. Absolutely it is. And we can do that. This is Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, who had healed perception, seeing the world, all is perfect, everything is perfect, there is no flaw anywhere, there is no flaw whatsoever, reality doesn't have any flaw. And this was, okay, now, what do we do? Okay, Now, let us go over to familiarity. Familiarity is the key to success. Familiarity is the key to success. Absolutely true. Absolutely true. Let's talk a little bit about this. And don't worry if we just kind of wander. This is actually a great technique to help you get familiar with healed perception. Because in healed perception, there's nothing you have to get rid of. You see that reality is flawless. So you don't have to have a plan or a structure. Okay, now how do I fix the problem with reality? There's nothing to fix. Nothing to fix. So we're trying to be relaxed here. And we sort of just spontaneously look here, look there, and relax into the familiarity. Familiarity is the key to success. Familiarity is the key to success. Now, the mistake that we make is we are taught and we teach ourselves this falsity that somehow that we can overcome familiarity by winning an argument or stating a fact once or getting it right on a test. Like, so let's say two people have an argument and one says, "I won the argument," and the other says, "Okay, I'm defeated." And so now, does winning an argument, does that then dispel the familiarity problem? Does it dispel it? Like, say, okay, it's gone. Ask yourself that question. Our only problem really is this terrible familiarity problem. I call it the continuity problem. It's the only problem we have. But it's a severe problem, a very severe problem, because we're so used to believing that reality is flawed, that to go from the belief that reality is flawed and all of our adjustments and defenses that we have used in this belief system, which are massive, to go from that massive belief system of fear, adjustments, defensiveness, confusion, all this, to go from that to, oh, reality doesn't have any flaw at all. I don't need any of these defenses or fear or adjustments or confusion. None of that is necessary. To go boom, boom, like that. Obviously, there's a continuity concern we have in our minds, isn't there? And we'd say, wait a minute, I'm familiar with this belief system. I'm not going to just, you know, I don't want it to vanish without a trace instantly forever. So we hold on to it. We hold on to what is familiar very tenaciously, especially when we think that to not hold on to it means we're going to be thrown into an abyss, which is not true, but our twisted logic tells us this. We're going to tenaciously hold on to it. And that's exactly what everyone does. And this is my observation here in this world. Coming into this world, I thought, hey, I can just explain the truth to people and they will accept it. No, 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 it doesn't work that way. And of course, I was a fool to even try that. And I'm sure the Holy Spirit told me it doesn't work that way. And I said, oh, no, I'm smart enough to listen to me. I can explain it clearly. It doesn't work that way at all. It's all about familiarity. Familiarity is the key to success. Familiarity is the key to success. Familiarity is the key to success. Believe this. This is true. You cannot simply get an answer, like ask that question, well, what's the answer? Oh, well, reality is it doesn't have any flaw. Oh, okay, thank you. That's all I need to know. Okay, I can write that down on a test and my teacher will say, oh, you gave the right answer. Okay. You get an A in the class. Okay, you get an A in the class. What does that have to do with overcoming the continuity fear, the severe fear of essentially an abyss, annihilation of an abyss? What is that? How does that dispel that? Dispel it. It doesn't. It doesn't do anything. Or let's say you have a discussion and argument, you want to decide who's right, who's telling the truth, and finally you come to an agreement. Okay, you're right. You've proved to me that reality doesn't have a flaw. Great. Okay. Now what? Now, well, you still have the continuity fear. You still have familiarity to deal with. It doesn't help you deal with familiarity hardly at all. It's ludicrous to think. I know there's the debates, you hear about the debates, Shankara debating and then defeating everyone and the debates and everyone converts over, says, you're right, okay. And now we'll do what you say. Well, they may have decided this is the path that we need to take. But it's not like you can get in a debate and you win the debate, and then the loser says, "Oh, okay, I'll accept what you have to say, I'm enlightened." You know, the familiarity problem vanishes just because you won a debate. This is nonsensical, magical type of belief that is just not rooted in any sort of pragmatic solution whatsoever. Doesn't work that way. Familiarity is the key to success. So, this is what everyone here in this world overlooks, conveniently. They're so afraid of the abyss, you know, they say, "Oh, no, I know how to do it, I just have to get the right answer, and I'll get an A in the class, and that's good enough." You know, people say, "Okay, you understand spiritual stuff." "Oh, yeah, I understand. Reality doesn't have any flaws." "Oh, good, you understand that too." Sure. Okay, let's call it good. Yeah. Okay, let's congratulate one another on our brilliance, you know. And then you sit around in an ivory tower for the rest of your life, congratulating each other on your brilliance. But your continuity fear remains the same. This utter dread of annihilation. Now, let us say that the truth is that reality has no flaw. Pure spaciousness has no fixations in it. Okay, there's nothing ever fixates in pure spaciousness, and therefore it doesn't. There is no fixation in reality. But let's say we're so used to looking at all these things in the world, and we believe it's all fixations. All this is crystallized fixations, and we see how beautiful that tree is, the landscapes, how beautiful the water, the world is. It's such a beautiful place of bliss. Look at these beautiful fixations. And then we hear, "Well, nothing is fixated. These aren't fixations." And then we say, "Oh my God, I'm going to lose all that beauty. I'm going to lose all that beauty." Let us say we're looking at a rope and it's so beautiful and so beautiful we think it's a snake. We say, "My gosh, look at that beautiful snake." And then someone tells us, we find out, "Oh, it's actually not a snake. It's just a very beautiful rope." And you say, "Oh my God, I'm losing the beautiful snake. How terrible. I'm losing all the beauty that snake had." You know. Now, we might think, "Well, wait a minute. Well, something crazy about that, isn't there? I mean, is the beauty dependent upon a label? We label it a snake and we think it's a beautiful snake, and then when someone removes the label, says, 'No, it's actually a beautiful rope,' does that mean the beauty vanishes?" Well, we think it does. I mean, there's a part of our mind that says, yeah, it's not there anymore. It's not there anymore. This is an example of how foolish we are. We can be when we're trying to hallucinate and imagine that reality has fixations, flaws. We get caught up in all sorts of fears that are unfounded fears, you might say. But the biggest fear, and the only real fear that really holds us back, is the continuity fear. We're just afraid of seeing that reality has no flaws, because what do we do about it? Right? What do we do about it? There's nothing to do about it. We're so used to doing, believing that we're doing, or believing we need to do something. I need to do something. I've got to do something. What can I do? What can I do? I need to do something. When reality doesn't have any flaws, well, what do I do then? Okay. So we're really quite, you know, frightened. Say, "Holy cow, I don't really want to succeed too fast. This, you know, I can't. I need to figure out what I need to do once I succeed. Well, what do I do then?" And of course, it's not an issue of doing. Doing implies fixing something in the way we look at it, making something right, making something better. But we say everything's perfect, you know, we say, "Well, there's no need for me then. I mean, no need for a doer then." That's right. But there is a need for a beer, and a beer actually is super, super creative. That unleashes our creativity and our creative play. To an extraordinary extent, and we're afraid of that too. We're afraid of going from being this sluggish doer to this totally inspired beer. So we have a continuity fear, and the only way to work on this is through familiarity. So again, you cannot get rid of familiarity by being smart. and saying, okay, here's a formula. Oh, okay, I see the formula. Okay, that gets rid of the familiarity problem. Familiarity is not an intellectual construct that you can just snap your fingers and say, whoops, I made a little mistake here, erase that, put this on the chalkboard, and okay, now it's right. Okay, it's gone now, no problem. It doesn't work that way, does it? Familiarity seems to be this unassailable problem for the intellect. Okay, for the intellect, it seems to be unassailable. We can't seem to get rid of it. Well, how do we get rid of it? In staying engaged with clarifying truth, which means day to day, every day, we make it our career. It is our career. It is the number one occupation of our lives, plain and simple. And this is actually what Shankara debated and told people the path. You need to look at it as you are, this is your career. And you're going to be engaged with this effort for your lifetime. This is a lifetime pursuit, as it were. Okay? It's a lifetime pursuit, which is what I've done with my life. I've made it a lifetime pursuit. Still in pursuit of healed perception. But I'm a little closer than I was when I started, I would say, or at least more familiar. I mean, more familiar with the whole situation, that there isn't any situation. Closer to realizing there is no closer. Everyone is already there. It's already here. There's nowhere we ever went. But basically, the familiarity problem has been evaporated. The continuity problem has been evaporated to a significant extent, I would say. Not to an ultimate extent yet, but to a very significant extent, because it made it my lifetime occupation. This is how I occupy my time and interest and attention, and this is the remedy, and this is what the great teachers point out. This is what they come here to tell us. You know, they don't come here to put on a beauty show. Okay, although they may appear that way, but the great teachers come here to tell us simply that we must make our primary occupation in this world is that of putting our attention on evaporating the continuity fear, and our goal is healed perception. And this is our primary occupation, and it's a lifetime occupation. It's a lifetime occupation. I know there are a lot of people who, you know, play golf, and they say, well, it's a lifetime sport, and they're still playing it when they're 80. Well, the spiritual path of evaporating the continuity fear is a lifetime occupation. This is what has to be instilled in everyone. And is that being instilled in this world right now, from cradle to grave? Or do we live in a culture where we're surrounded by people who make the spiritual path their lifetime occupation? It's a rhetorical question, isn't it? I was fortunate. My dad actually did make it his lifetime occupation, and so I had that example, and I had that assurance that yes this is what is important. Is more, and he viewed it as more important than anything else, more important than job, more important than family, more important than anything. So certainly, I was able to breathe that air a little bit, and I had it within me already as I was born. I already had it, determination. I said, I got to do this. This is, I'm tired of returning to this world over and over, getting a return ticket. And I would imagine that you are too, right? All the viewers are too. But it is not going to be taken care of magically. Magically, okay, it is a familiarity issue. Now, the Roman Catholic Church sort of has this, but it has some issues. It really has some issues. But the idea of going to Mass every day this is what they're trying to, and taking the Eucharist really is, it means, what Jesus told us is to consider his words and the spirit in which he gave those words every day continuously. This is actually the Last Supper, what he told us. And because his body and flesh, he made it very clear in what he said, are not his literal body and flesh, but the words and the spirit is what gives life. Okay, the flesh profiteth nothing. So we're supposed to, he calls us, Christians are called to a daily commitment to clarification of truth and evaporating the continuity fear, and daily commitment to healed perception. Daily commitment to healed perception. As are those of every religion, actually. They're called the daily remembrance, daily focus, okay, on the goal, okay, and the means to the goal. It is our primary responsibility here. Ananda Maima told us that our primary responsibility, in fact, she said the only responsibility we have in this world is to focus on the spiritual path, healed perception, and the means to that, and an all-out commitment to it. That's it. That's our responsibility here, actually. And so we have to do it daily, okay? Religion is not a Sunday thing. It's a daily thing. Those who just do it on Saturday or Sunday are kidding themselves, are really kidding themselves. They're just, what they do is they maintain an aura of righteousness, self-righteousness, and try to get rid of a little bit of guilt and concern that they have. Say, well, I go to church on Sunday. No, religion is daily commitment. It's a lifelong commitment. It is your true career, actually. And why? Because the familiarity problem. Okay, if it was just a matter of somebody besting you in a debate, and when they showed you the truth, you said, oh, great, I'm enlightened, no more problems, then now everyone would have been enlightened a long time ago. Okay? It's not that at all. I mean, if someone can talk truth to you till they're blue in the face, it's not going to get rid of your continuity fear just like that at all. It doesn't work that way at all. So one has to find some way to remain engaged, to remain engaged, to remain engaged, to remain engaged, whether by, you know, books, by association, by your own meditation, your own thinking, you know, videos, audio, making assertions, you know, your spiritual practice, your prayers, your contemplation, trying to tie everything that happens into you as if it were a living play. Your life was a living play, they call it in the Hindu lila, a living play of grace that is reminding you of your goal of healed perception and the means to it. All the time it's reminding you, it's cluing you in, it's keeping your attention on it. This is what has to be done. Because the continuity fear is so severe, we have put so much repetitive learning belief in our belief that reality is flawed. We have reinforced that in every little detail for so much that we really have this very severe continuity fear, where we feel very frightened that something terrible is going to happen to us if we see that reality is perfect. We think we will cease to exist and that all beauty will vanish, and, you know, all these threats that we've made and compounded, etc. So we're really kind of very nervous and hesitant about it, and only gradually do we dispel the continuity fear. It's a day-to-day thing, but we do have success, and managing our success is also a big challenge on the path, which is what we do here. This is what we specialize in, is managing our success. It's not always easy. I had a hard time today. I made so much success yesterday. I was furious that I hadn't finished, you know. I said, this is crazy. You know, I should be done by now. You know, what's the problem? You know, you get really, really frustrating, because I realized, wow, I really, really But it stirs up, you know, residual resistances. And so it requires a great deal of patience. Now, we don't really want to fail in our endeavors here, in reaching healed perception, because the world is going in a very bad direction, actually, which I always have made great efforts to point out. Don't be fooled by what's taking place in the world right now. And I think many already know this. Okay, so the remedy is that don't focus too much on how terrible the world is and detail it. Now, we understand artificial intelligence, the way this world is going. It's actually so terrible, I can't even explain it, actually. It's so bad. It is severe delay. So, we focus on success, setting delay down as quickly as possible, And to do this, we keep our attention on the pointers that we need, the assertions that we need, telling us that you know, keep reinforcing. By reinforcing, we get familiar with it. So it's not some linear program of progress that, like in schooling, we read a book and, okay, we start out here and we go here. It's not like a path like that. It's an overall holistic familiarity, a comfort zone of familiarity we get into. So we don't have to worry like, oh, wait a minute, how do I, you know, this linear cognitive thinking of we're building something, you know. It's not like we're building something, putting some structure together. We're just relaxing into hearing the truth, saying, remembering the truth. Oh, that I remember. That rings a bell. Do I have a bell here? I wonder if I still have a bell here. I used to have a bell here, but I don't know if I still do. I do have something here, but how do I ring it? Let me see. Oh, I found it. Great. Okay, I found this little bell here. This is actually a Tibetan singing bell or something. Let me put this on the computer. And this is just like an attention getter. It'll... put my microphone in there. I just put the microphone in there so you could hear it, you know. It's a wonderful little attention getter. And when we have this remembrance, it's like ringing a bell, like this bell, boom. It gets rung like that. And it's reverberating like that, you see. And it's like, wow. It keeps going, right? This is what happens when we get remembrance. It's like our bell gets rung. The bell of remembrance gets rung. What do then? We just sit quietly and say, wow. It's still ringing. Very faint, but it's still, you know. So, we get saturated, subtly saturated by this bell being rung. The bell of remembrance gets rung. This is what we do. This is what practice is all about. It's a matter of continually ringing that bell of remembrance. We're not driving, you know, to some place or some point we arrive at. It's not that. Familiarity problem is not like that. We just gradually get this more and more ease and feel familiar with this. And they say, oh yeah, the bell of remembrance. Oh, great. So it gets rung more and more. And eventually they'll just be this, will just abide in remembrance, remembrance, healed perception. And we'll say, oh, yeah, I feel very comfortable here. And it won't be an analytical thing. It just says, oh, this is my home. I feel comfortable here. This is where I'm just, there's no reason for me not to abide in here, you know. No reason to not abide in the vision of perfection, of flawlessness, vision of oneness. No reason, no. I feel comfortable. So we wonder why we struggle, takes such a long time. Of course it will. Of course it does. Of course it's a struggling with familiarity. And we want to be able to solve the problem as if it were some analytical, mathematical problem. Familiarity is not a mathematical problem to be solved. Okay, it's not an academic problem to be solved. It's not like a chemical problem. Oh, here's the right catalyst. Put that in. Boom, it works now. It's not anything like that. The familiarity problem remains until you've gradually shifted it and moved it into a new landscape where you're now familiar with healed perception. Before we were familiar with false perception. Now we're familiar with healed perception. But it certainly is like crossing a bridge. It takes you a while. The bridge we're crossing over the abyss is familiarity. So we gradually get used to truth, which is perfection. Flawless perfection, and we gradually leave behind falsity, lies, which is the belief that there's a flaw in reality. This is just how it goes. Now, can we speed it up? Absolutely, we can speed it up. As a matter of fact, teachings such like this were designed to speed it up. Were designed. This is radical Dzogchen is designed to speed it up. It says, you know, this is the way to do it in one lifetime, actually. So, if, you know, those who are really getting their bell of remembrance rung through radical Dzogchen are on the, you know, fast-tracking it, for sure. Very much fast-tracking it. And they may indeed finish this in this life before the body passes away. They may actually have healed perception and see that they're... There are no fixations in pure spaciousness. Nothing is fixated in pure spaciousness. Nothing fixates pure spaciousness. Pure spaciousness remains this absolute, seamless, zero-dimensional, attribute-free, pristine, clear purity, untouched. They may very well do that, and we may very well do that. I certainly hope so for everyone. So, see, in listening, again, it's a non-academic listening. You're just allowing the bell of remembrance to be rung. That's it. You're allowing it. It's not like saying, okay, I need to remember what's being said here, and so I can repeat it like a parrot. You know, that is not proper listening or hearing. That is not really truly hearing what's being said. The purpose is just keep hearing it, and then it will permeate, and somehow you will feel within you a remembrance like, oh, yeah, I remember far, far away, long, long ago, it seems so distant. I just faintly, but I seem to recall what this is talking about. I seem to recall that I used to experience that. It seems like long ago. Well, keep in mind that we can have a dream of time, and the dream of time can literally say, well, this dream is an ancient dream. You know, keep this in mind. We can start out a dream. We can start out a dream as if the dream were already ancient. Okay, this is what we've done. Very clever indeed. And so when we fall asleep, what if we fell asleep and we dream that we've been experiencing for billions of years? We can start out the dream. The very first moment of the dream can be, wow, I've been a body going through all this odyssey for billions of years. And we don't realize that that only takes just like one moment of dreaming. We can dream as a dream, a billion-yearness, so to speak. And we think, oh, you know, this has been going on for billions of years, when it's actually been going on for only just one moment. Very clever. And we just assume, we start dreaming, and we say, oh, okay, this is like the first, this is like, okay, I'm in a dream, I'm dreaming, so I'm just starting out, and I say, oh, I'm just starting out, this is fresh, and this is new, and everything is just beginning here, and the dream's just beginning, this is all just barely beginning. No. We can start a dream with millions of worlds and universe and skeletons and evolution and all this stuff already present, and we're there as if all this stuff has already happened in time. But we're just actually hallucinating this scenario just this instant. But in awaking from the dream, if we think that we're the person in the dream, we think, well, oh my gosh, how can I possibly awaken for this? Look how long I've been, you know, in this dream. I actually experienced that. I woke up once, and I was sort of drowsy, and I was dreaming this dream of like millions of years, and I was traveling through it all. And it seemed like just the longest time possible. And then I woke up, and then I said, wait a minute. I just dozed off just a few moments ago, actually. And then I realized that I'd only just dozed off just momentarily. And yet I thought I had been dreaming for millions of years, or in this scenario of millions of years. But actually, it was just a moment. Just a moment. So we may think that we're somehow lost in time and space, and reality is far, far distant. We've been away for so long, and all this stuff, you know. Now, we have been compounding and dreaming this dream of time over and over and over and over, reinforcing this craziness, the stupidity, reinforcing this fear. That is true. Certainly, we've done that. But each moment, a dream of time, in the moment we're believing this, that moment can contain, you know, billions of years of time in our belief, in our feeling. We believe this. We believe that this moment contains a billion years of time, and then we believe it's linear. It's not linear. It's all being presented at the same moment. So the dream of time is actually not linear at all. In fact, there's no linearness to it at all. All of time that we're feeling and believe is only being imagined this moment, moment by moment by moment by moment by moment. And again, what do we make of this? Nothing. We just let the bell of remembrance be rung a little bit here, right? Just say, huh, that's quite interesting. Full stop in the wow. Don't try to figure it out. This is what's meant by wow. You know, wow, you mean, you know, these billions of years actually is all just being presented in this moment as a belief? Yeah. That means actual time doesn't even exist, does it? That's right. Actual time doesn't even exist at all. Every moment that we're feeling time is projected moment by moment by moment to feel as if it contained, you know, vast amounts of time. Just as we can fall asleep and dream, we dream of like a universe, and all the space of the universe is there simultaneously when we have this image of it, right? Same thing with time. It's just an image. We're having this image we call time, an image of a billion years of time. That image is just one image, as a, you know, 1 billion year image of we call time. And again, full stop in the wow. The bell of remembrance is being rung, and we just accept it and say, oh, great. Now, this is a shocker, isn't it? It's a shocker. Time is just an image. Space is just an image, actually. When we're dreaming, don't we, whatever we're dreaming, doesn't what everything appears, is it just all there? It's all there. When did it get built? And all the houses you see in the dream, when did they get built? Don't they have age on them? Don't you see stuff in the dream that appears to be aged? Well, where did it get aged? It's only images we're seeing. Images in the moment, images of agedness, images of age, images of time. And just like a movie, image, 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 it seems as if it's some sort of continuous truth to it. No, it's not. As if we were journeying through millions of years of time, the image of millions of years is there each moment, each moment, each moment. But we may... We may put ourselves somewhere on some, move ourselves in the image, each image, or a little different position, and then we claim we're journeying through time. We're journeying through time. And each moment, we seem to think, look back and say, oh, I've journeyed all the way from the beginning there, and I have all this way to go, where it's actually just a flat image, as it were, of what we call time. And we're never really in time at all. And our so-called position on this image of time doesn't make any difference at all, does it? Don't turn it over to the intellect. Don't turn anything that's said over to the intellect. This is the key. Now, there's a lot of Buddhist terminology in the book Spaciousness. But Longchenpa himself says that this isn't Buddhism. Don't worry about any of this, actually. It's just pointing to the fact that there's nothing is ever fixated, actually. It's pointing to healed perception. He starts out a prologue, says, homage to glorious Kuntu Zangpo, which really refers to, like, we would say, God the Father, the you know, pure spacious, the ground of all being. Sri Samantabhadra, which is another name for the same. Homage to the all good Buddha, another terminology. This is the Buddhism became stylized. So this is sort of a stylistic beginning. Homage to pristine spontaneity, the clear light of luminous mind, the amazing reality of this fantastic universe, a treasury of self-sprung awareness in the now, and the source of everything, samsara and nirvana. Homage to that motionless space of simplicity. So he introduces that motionless space of simplicity. This matrix of the apex approach, the peak orbited by sun and moon, this matrix of the Vajra heart, the clear light of spontaneity, this matrix is naturally disposed without effort or practice. Listen while I describe this awesome investiture of the now. So this matrix is naturally disposed without effort or practice. So we hear that and we say, huh? This matrix of motionless, the motionless space of simplicity, the motionless space of simplicity is naturally disposed without effort or practice. This motionless space of simplicity is naturally disposed without effort or practice. This motionless space of simplicity is naturally disposed without effort or practice. This motionless space of simplicity is naturally disposed without effort or practice. Now we're saying, huh. Not used to hearing anything like that. This motionless space of simplicity is naturally disposed without effort or practice. Without effort or practice. Without effort or practice. It's naturally this disposed, naturally this way. Without effort or practice. And we're saying like, wow. We're so used to effort and practice. You know, just to hear this is just a wow. This motionless space of simplicity, utter simplicity, a motionless space, it doesn't move, of utter simplicity. There isn't anything other than this just motionless space with the utmost simplicity is naturally disposed without practice or effort. Without practice or effort. Now, the feeling that kind of arises is right now for me is rather frantic. So wait a minute, you know, I got to get away from this. Got to get away. We got to get away. No effort or practice. See, we think that all of reality is engaged in this frantic effort and practice full of motion and complexity to solve the flaw, to avoid the flaw, to adjust to it, to work around it, to get away from it. And so we're so used to believing in that, to hear that there's this motionless space of simplicity naturally disposed without effort or practice. So our choice is to say, oh, that's weird, or we can say, oh, wow. This is the choice we have. It's either we say it's either weird or wow, and we don't want to try and split the difference, which is what the ego wants us to do. The ego always advises us to split the difference between truth and lies. But they're both absolutes, aren't they, actually? Either truth is perfect. Either reality's perfect or it's not perfect. Those are absolute statements. You can't have, there is no difference to split. If one is true, the other is false. And this is very important to keep reminding yourself of this, because the ego is very insidious. We'll always say, well, just all I got to do is split the difference. Be smart, split the difference. That's what the ego will tell you. The ego will tell you, didn't I teach you anything in school? Isn't your education worth anything? Just split the difference. What is this nonsense? And you're done with it. That's obvious, the ego says. No, it's obviously wrong, obviously totally mistaken. Either truth is flawless or it isn't. There's no splitting the difference. What is splitting the difference? And something is either this or it isn't this. How do you split that difference? Either reality is perfect or it isn't. So splitting the difference would mean what? It's both perfect and imperfect. What you have there is that you have confusion then. So really what the ego is really counseling us to enter into confusion. Plain and simple, cut and dried. That's exactly what the ego is advising us. The ego's advice to us always is confusion. Always. It's very clever at packaging. It has to be. If we saw it was offering us confusion, we would say, thanks, but no thanks. Thanks for all the effort, you know, but no, I don't want the confusion. So the ego is always offering us confusion and nothing but confusion. And the more we can recognize this, the better off we'll be. The more we'll say no to the ego. Say, no. And I don't want to listen to you. So we have to decide. Either reality is perfect or it's flawed. If it's flawed, then when we hear this talk, we'll say, oh, that's weird. Yeah, that's weird. See, that doesn't fit in with what I, you know, that's just a weirdness, what you're saying. It's not true. When we're saying, well, it's weird that I feel like it's true, but I know it isn't, so it's weird. See, this is what will happen when you believe, trust in the ego. You'll say, huh, it seems to ring a bell of remembrance, but I know it's not true, so that's really weird. Why do I feel some sort of remembrance to this? It can't possibly have ever been true, so that's weird. See, that's the reaction. It's weird. Whereas if you say, wow, you say, oh, yeah, I remember this is true. Reality is perfect. I only tried to, on a whim, be greater than God by claiming that there was a flaw in reality and just overlooking the fact that there wasn't, just pretending that there was a flaw, just hallucinating there was a flaw. So this is reminding me of truth. I say, oh, wow, that's great. So, you know, if you're one of those ones who have the wow reaction, you probably realize in your life that you're sort of, you know, an island, because most of the people around you in your life react to this stuff like, oh, that's kind of weird. Yeah, that's weird. That's weird. And you are saying, oh, no, that's great. It's wow. Wow, that's I love that remembrance. That's just a stunning remembrance. That's great. Wow. So easy to assess where you're at if you're able to, you know, react in the wow. And when you react in the wow, when your response is wow, you go into this full stop, quiet mind, neutral sort of state, and just appreciate it and get used to this. Oh, I just love the ringing of that bell of remembrance. I just love it. I just want to marinate in it, you know. That's what you will do. Whereas if your reaction is, oh, that's weird, you're going to start asking a whole bunch of questions, just saying, now, why am I thinking that this is true when I know it's not? I mean, why, you know, how come I want to get rid of this weirdness, you know? And then start asking millions of questions. This is the ego. That's the ego. So when I hear this, this motionless simplicity that naturally is supposed without effort or practice, I say, wow, yeah, that's exactly right. And that's it. It's just, I say, let this remembrance reverberate. There's no questions to ask. I already know, you know, why we have a continuity problem. I know the only problem I have is a continuity problem. I know why we have a continuity problem, because we try to be greater than God, and we've been, you know, reinforcing this false belief that a flawed reality for, you know, over and over and over. So that's it. No other questions to ask. And the answer is to simply, you know, assert the truth and get used to it. That's it. So there really aren't any questions that really arise. I just appreciate the remembrance. Just appreciate the remembrance. Okay. Now let us see what we can do here. We're going to move on from this slide. And we're going to... I'm going to grab it's hard to see because the light is the sunlight is hitting me, but I'm going to, there you go, okay. Canto 1 spaciousness. This is like the first chapter in spaciousness. We'll just do a little wandering around in this, you know. You don't even have to read it straight through. You just kind of wander around if you want. But we'll say that everything arises in the vast matrix of spontaneity. This is a difficult word to translate. Exactly what does that meant, but we don't concern about that. It's just enough to say everything arises in this vast matrix, this vast motionless, simple matrix, naturally disposed without effort or practice. Everything arises in the vast matrix of spontaneity, and spontaneity is the ground of everything. But empty in essence, never crystallizing. Empty in essence, never crystallizing. The ground is nothing, although it appears as everything. Samsara and nirvana arise as spontaneity in the trikaya, which means three-bodied matrix. Three-bodied matrix. And don't worry about any of this. It just, yet they can never stir from their intrinsic spaciousness. For such are the blissful fields of reality. The nature of mind is an unchanging, sky-like supermatrix, a matrix of variable display, compassionate magical emanation. Everything is ornamentation of spaciousness and nothing else. Everything is ornamentation of spaciousness and nothing else. Everything is ornamentation of spaciousness and nothing else. We can just stop on that for a moment, can't we? That's a very abstract statement. Abstraction means there's no exceptions. You know, zero is zero. Zero is an abstraction. Zero is zero. There's nothing there. If they say there's nothing there, that doesn't mean there's something there. It means there's nothing there, actually. And again, you can't split the difference between something and nothing. Can you? Can you split that difference? The ego is offering us what? Confusion. We don't want confusion. Everything is ornamentation of spaciousness and nothing else. And nothing else. So as we let this percolate in our mind, we might feel this, wow. I've never thought about that. I haven't thought of it that way in a long time. So you see, it's okay to stop. As the bell is rung, as your bell of remembrance is rung, just you don't have to go rushing forward to get to the end of the story. It's not really a story. See, everything is ornamentation of spaciousness and nothing else. There's not some story that's taking place. There's not a story. It's not a story. It's just ornamentation and nothing else. So we don't have to get to the end of the story. We're trying to make it seem like a story, but it's just mere ornamentation and nothing else. And that is and then the long chapter elaborates upon this, sort of, you know, reinforce. But sometimes we don't have to reinforce by more and more reading. We just full stop on the what. We get it. We say, oh my gosh, it's all appearances is ornamentation and nothing else. Ornamentation of spaciousness and nothing else. Ornamentation of spaciousness and nothing else. That reorients our perspective, doesn't it? Reorients our perspective. That's a game changer. So we don't have to keep reading necessarily here. Sometimes additional words just get in the way. In this motionless matrix of simplicity, naturally disposed, free of all effort and practice, all display in this, all appearances in this spaciousness, naturally disposed, free of effort and practice, all appearances are mere ornamentation, and nothing else, are just ornamentation and nothing else. So this is very contrary to what we are believing, isn't it? It sort of stops the mind almost, doesn't it? It's like we become sort of sluggish in our mind, stunned by it. But this is what we want to get to in our practice, is feeling that, getting the bell of remembrance rung very strongly. And this is such an astonishing statement. As all appearances are mere ornamentation and nothing in spaciousness and nothing else. Everything, he says, everything. Everything is ornamentation of spaciousness and nothing else. Everything is ornamentation of spaciousness and nothing else. Everything is ornamentation of spaciousness and nothing else. Everything is ornamentation of spaciousness, nothing else. And spaciousness is this motionless simplicity naturally disposed without effort or practice. This motionless simplicity naturally disposed without effort or practice. Everything in this spaciousness is ornamentation and nothing else. Everything is ornamentation in spaciousness and nothing else. Everything is ornamentation of spaciousness and nothing else. And nothing else. And nothing else. So there's no difference to split there, is there? There's no difference to split. What is the ego marketing, selling us, offering us? Confusion. Confusion, confusion, confusion. As if it's doing us a favor. The ego says, my gosh, this dialectic you're faced with of either this or this is so stressful for you. That's terrible. Let me give you some help here. Split the difference and you won't be so confused. Or you won't be so bothered. You know, split the difference. You won't be so bothered. Well, this is a bother that we, you know, how can you choose between two options unless you see both clearly? You know, it may be stressful, it may bother us, and we say, wow, this is tough going. Yeah, it is a little difficult, but it's something we have to look at. Everything, he doesn't say some things. He says everything. Everything, 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 everything. Everything, everything. Everything is mere, is a, everything is ornamentation of spaciousness and nothing else. Everything is ornamentation of spaciousness and nothing else. Everything is ornamentation of spaciousness and nothing else. Okay, so everything, where is the splitting the difference? Is he saying some things? No, everything. There's no difference to split. It's either some things or everything. There isn't any difference to split between the two of those. It's like either it's one or it's zero. Yeah. Either there's something there or there isn't. Either it's everything or it's not everything. He says everything is ornamentation of spaciousness and nothing else. So again, nothing else. Is that something to split a difference? We say, well, it's there's nothing else and something else, so let's split the difference between nothing else and something else. Let's split the difference between nothing else and something else. Can we split that difference? Or is the ego offering us confusion? Because obvious confusion is we think we should be able to see something that doesn't exist, and we're confused. How come I can't see it? How come I can't see the difference between zero and one? I mean, are everything and not everything. Well, how come I can't see it? Then we get very confused, and we go back and forth. Our mind goes back and forth between everything and not everything, everything, not everything. And we keep going, referencing back, say, okay, now, trying to say, okay, now, what would be the difference between the two? How would I split the difference between these two? So our mind is really, our mind is really, and we're in a state of confusion. What it's really doing is it's oscillating very rapidly oscillating between, you know, the two options in effort to be inspired enough to see, where is that different? Where is splitting that difference? What is that like? And we can't see it. We can't find it. And in this oscillation, we feel very confused. How come I can't find it? And I'm trying to blur the two together. I'm oscillating, and I think it gets blurry. I'm not sure. But you really just become unsure of either option. And you think being unsure of either option is you're splitting the difference. Yeah, I'm not sure of either option. I'm confused because I'm going back and forth so fast that now I'm unsure of either option, and we think, okay, now I've split the difference. Now I've split the difference. And we think we're really smart. It says, wow. But we feel like, yeah, but there's still something wrong. I mean, I feel I've got it, but there's resistance. You know, resistance. And like, I feel kind of fearful. And I kind of feel like I'm like the abyss. I feel I might fall into the abyss. Well, obviously, if we think we found something that doesn't exist, and you know, we're literally, you know, looking at an abyss, as it were. Right? And so we think if we clarify it, we'll fall into an abyss. No, we won't fall into an abyss. We'll still simply see the two options as they are. They're both clear, and realize they can't split the difference. So I don't need to oscillate and blur the two and think that there's this third option that splits the difference that I'm now abiding in, which is really, I'm abiding in this mental abyss because it's not there. So I'm abiding in nothing. So of course we're afraid of the abyss. We think if we wake up to where we are, we'll see we're in an abyss. No, we won't. We'll wake up and realize the nature of confusion is this, you know, trying to oscillate so rapidly between two options, then blur the two, get confused about the two, that we think we've come across a third option. But actually, a third option was never there. So we were abiding in an imaginary abyss. So obviously, when we wake up, when we recognize this, then we no longer feel like we're biting an imaginary abyss. If we have a dream of an imaginary abyss, and we wake up from that dream and realize, oh, there is no abyss, how can we say, oh, I've now fallen into an abyss? I have not. So looking at the nature of confusion is very important here. Looking at the nature of confusion, which is what the ego tells us, that's the answer. The ego says, I've seen the answer. For the continuity problem, familiarity problem, just split the difference. Splitting the price you pay for splitting the difference is believing you're in an abyss, and then you end up trying to hold on to confusion as if confusion is your home in the abyss. It's your safety. If without the confusion, you would be in this abyss. No, without the confusion, you wouldn't be blurring the two options and thinking there's a third option. You'd recognize, there's no difference to split here. So I'm not going to be oscillating between the two. I'm going to just see clearly both at once without trying to oscillate between the two, and then focus on which one is right. So you're not trying to oscillate back and forth. So you don't feel this confusion. So you don't feel you're biting an imaginary abyss, clinging to confusion, clinging to this imaginary third option as if it were your safety, as if it were your shelter in some terrible vast ocean, merciless, cold, dark ocean, a little island you're clinging to. Now, this is the first time I've ever been able to see this. Very significant when you're able to recognize this. Now, Jesus makes a big deal about this. This is one of his very important keys that are emphasized. You know, truth and lies can't both be true. You know, and only truth is true. there isn't a difference to split between truth and lies. Either one is true and the other's not. It can't both be true. And so, if one is true, the other is false. Therefore, there isn't any difference to split between them. It simply is completely false. It's a zero. Can you split the difference between one and zero? No, whatever you have left over isn't zero. So if truth is one and lies are zero, can you split the one and have some of zero in that? No. But we keep splitting. We think in our mind, split, fragment, thinking that we're, getting closer to zero. Are we really getting closer to zero? Can we get close to zero? Can we get close to nothing? Is a little crumb closer to nothing than a big rock? Is it closer to being zero, to nothing at all? Is it really closer to that? Isn't nothing an absolute? And isn't something an absolute? So how can an absolute get closer to another absolute? Right. Just sort of, you know, let that marinate. So if truth is true, then lies are not true. If lies are true, then truth is not true. You can't have them both be true. Either everything is ornamentation, is ornamentation of spaciousness, or not everything is ornamentation of spaciousness. And either it's nothing else other than ornamentation, that's all that is nothing else, or it's something else. It can't be both nothing else and something else. Both are absolutes. Can an absolute be said to be getting closer to another absolute? You can't divide absolutes up. You can't make them less. They're absolutes. So how can, if you can't make it less or more, how can we say it's getting closer to some other absolute, which also can't be less or more? So the abyss is believing that there is some middle ground between mutual exclusive absolutes, and believing we're dwelling there. So we're believing we're dwelling in an abyss. We're believing that we're dwelling in an abyss, but we think the ground that we stand upon is confusion, is stable. But confusion is just blurred oscillation. There isn't any actual third option, so it feels very unstable, like it's not really there. You know, we're like constantly having to reinforce the notion that it something should be there. But when we stop that, stop trying to oscillate, and find a split the difference between mutual exclusive absolutes, then, you know, we're on the solid ground of recognizing, well, you can't do that. That's only going to generate confusion and fear to try to do that. So you say, well, what do we do? Well, we choose truth. And you say, yeah, but I got a continuity fear. You say, oh, fine, okay, but we'll work on that. Okay, we'll work on that. So don't need to enter into confusion. Just enter into the wow. Had a dream a couple nights ago, and I was on this boat, and this boat, I stepped on the boat, and I looked to look inside. I said, wow, it's so smooth in there. How'd you get this finish? It's fantastic. And the boat started to move out into the ocean, and I was standing on some very thin little ledge on the side of the boat. And as the boat went further and further out to the sea, I got tired. I said, hey, I can't keep holding on here. I'm going to fall into the ocean. I was just scared. And I was talking to somebody there inside the boat. pleading, help, 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 help. I feel my strength is giving out. My strength is giving out. And then suddenly I realized that whoever I was speaking with didn't have the capacity to help me. They weren't going to help me. They were listening, sympathetic, or actually they were kind of conversing with me, actually. But the notion of actually pulling, you know, helping me, didn't seem to register with them. I kept saying, "Can't you see? My situation is so precarious. Can't you see that? I'm going to fall in this ocean. Can't you see that? I'm losing my strength. Can't you see that?" And I kept getting so perturbed because this person, they were just smiling and talking, but they couldn't relate to what to do about it. They had no idea what to do about it. Finally, I said, "Gosh, this isn't working." And I looked, and there was this another person in the boat. And I yelled out to this person, "Hey, you know, help, help, help. I'm desperate situation here, help." And then this person immediately saw my situation and recognized it and said, "Oh yeah, okay, okay," and knew what to do. And this person was very, very heavy. Very heavy. They had these sort of thick glasses on too, very heavy. And they had this, some kind of threefold hook or something, threefold. And they threw that over and sort of hooked me. And then they had some leverage and they used their weight, the very much weightiness, to leverage me over the side of the boat into the boat. I was quite astonished. I said, "Wow, they really knew what they were doing. And yeah, they're expert at it." So I was saved. Now, just today, yesterday, I was looking for my reading glasses, and I couldn't find them. I said, "I've lost them." And then just today, I was so frustrated outside, I looked, and I saw they had dropped on the ground underneath something. And I said, "Oh my gosh, there they are," and I put them on. And then I said, "Holy cow, I look like that man in the dream in the boat that was so heavy and weighted, I was able to, you know, pull me over the side and into safety." And I was thinking, you know, we have the truth within us, and we also have this needy, frightened part within us, right? The needy, frightened part is actually the continuity fear of the world. That's what it actually is. And when we come into this world, we get infected by that, as it were. And we don't know what to do about it. But there's an aspect of ourselves which is like the guru. As a matter of fact, Ananda Maima pointed this out. If I can go back to that picture. Where in her life, she went through this sort of a spiritual path, an initiation, where she was both the devotee, the path, and the guru, all in one, three in one. So in this person I saw in the boat had this three-in-oneness, had this three-in-oneness about them, and they used this to pull this pleading, frightened person who felt they're going to drown into the boat and save them. So I look at myself. I'm both the frightened person and the world saying, "Oh my gosh, help, help, help." Then I'm the discipline of the practice also, and then I'm also the guru. Who has the clarity. So I'm like three in one. So like I'm in the dream, I must have been the three in one being that pulled this being to safety, so to speak. Maybe pulled. That's very interesting, this situation. And Ananda my Ma, in her Leela of Sadhana in Bhajatpur, Brahman Bharya district, I believe it's Brahman Bharya still, in what's now Bangladesh, Bhajatpur, Bhajatpur. She spent several years living there, and she actually went through innumerable spiritual paths. So she played the role of the spiritual aspirant, the path, and the guru, all three in one, but she did it with like innumerable spiritual aspirants. Innumerable. I mean, she said she'd go through hundreds maybe every day, maybe even thousands of paths, all the way to completion. It's really the most extraordinary situation I've ever heard of. And so she knew all paths because she went through thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands, innumerable situations where she was both the frightened aspirant, the spiritual path of ways and means, and the guru who pulling the aspirant to safety. You know, all three, the wise guru who knew everything, the path, and the aspirant, all three. So she was able to advise everyone she met. She was able to advise them from direct experience of having gone through that path herself, so to speak, in this three in one approach. So in this dream, it may very well have been a dream of myself, because of the glasses. I say, hey, wait a minute, you know that, and these are in my normal glasses are the same way. I wear my normal glasses, and I say, like, you know, that's what this heavyweight in the dream looked like. And the heavyweight signifies a guru. Guru really means something to do with, you know, super heavy, very weighty, very, very weighty in wisdom, very weighty in wisdom. So, and I was looking at a forklift today and carrying real heavy loads, and I said, how does that forklift not tip over? It was amazing how heavy the loads they can carry on this small little thing. And of course, in the rear of the forklift is all this structure that looks like it's very functional, but actually it's very heavy iron or steel, weighted steel. I don't even know if it may even be lead or something. It's very heavy. And so there's a counterbalance there in the forklift. But I'm still surprised it doesn't tip over the loads they carry. So heavy. So the guru has this counterbalancing weight to them, a weight of clarity. And so they're able to use that, and they're able to then pull this frightened aspirant, you know, over the side of this boat and into safety without themselves, you know, being pulled into the sea, as it were, the ocean. It's the weightiness that they have. Now, certainly, I've found it very difficult in this world to have enough weightiness to help anyone, because this aspirantness in us is so frightened of the abyss. You know, saying, I'm going to fall into the abyss, I'm so frightened, you know, help, and split the difference. How do I split the difference? How do I get this confusion so I can hold on, like, cling to it? And it's very difficult to withstand this, the pull that they have of fear and confusion. The sun has just gone down. Suddenly the temperature just dropped significantly here. How are we doing? Pretty good. So maybe the dream signified that I finally have the weightiness now to help. And seeing this issue of confusion. Wow. trying to split the difference between mutually exclusive absolutes, and the ego offering us nothing but confusion. This is why we're so terrified. We feel so weak. We're trying to find a stable nothingness, a stable confusion. You know, where's that stability in splitting the difference? Because we think that's the answer. We think we're being smart. Split this. So we've got to split the difference. I don't see any other way around it. There's no way around this problem. We don't understand the problem as one of familiarity. And we're always told that the true guru is the inner guru. It's within us. It's within us. So somehow I activated the inner guru in this dream because I got fed up with talking to this person that wasn't taking any action, didn't have the answer. They just kind of sympathetic listener, you know, yeah. Or I don't know if they're sympathetic or not. They just kind of like sort of looked at me like, you know, what's wrong? I don't quite understand what you're, you know, what's wrong? And that may have just been what the intellect, huh? Yeah, the intellect doesn't understand what's wrong. That is for sure. The intellect thinks it's being real smart, splitting the difference between mutually exclusive absolutes. So its advice to me, you know, that dream was, well, just hang on, you know. I think that's what it was telling me. Come on, you can do it. You can hang on. Just hang in there. You can hang on. And I said, no, I can't. You know, and literally in my life, I'm not able to hang on. My shoulders and my elbows are giving out. And I'm feeling like I can't really hang on anymore. I'm really desperate. And some of you may be feeling the same way. You may be feeling really desperate, like you just can't hang on anymore in your life. And I think it was this desperation that I finally said, hey, I just can't keep talking to this advisor who keeps telling me to hang on. I gotta get saved here. And that's when I saw this, there's another someone over there. I said, wow, hey, help. And then, oh, immediately they responded. Said, yeah, okay. Says, okay, listen, this is what we're going to do. Okay, this and this and we're going to do this and whoosh, there you go. Okay, you're saved. And I said, ah, thank you. That's fantastic what you did. And I can see how you did it. It's your weightiness. I saw. I said, wow, you're so weighty that you could use this leverage to pull me to safety like that. I said, where'd you get that weightiness? I mean, that is terrific weightiness. See, this other one couldn't pull me to safety. They had no weight to them. They had no weight. They had no substance. Like a thin waif, you know, they tried to pull me, I pull them overboard, you know. So the intellect has no weightiness, has no real weightiness at all. It just has what it calls smartness, cleverness, trickiness, strategies, plans. It has no true weightiness. It has no true weightiness. The guru is, you know, that which is weighty, heavy. The heaviness of truth, you know, the weightiness that can't be pulled into a falsity, cannot be pulled into it. Certainly. I'm desperate this time for lots of reasons. It's a whole constellation of reasons. I'm burned out on trying to hang on in this world that seems to have no stability to it whatsoever. It's just a matter of hanging on here. We're just hanging on, feeling that if we don't, we'll just fall into an abyss. Hanging on to confusion, which is we believe the splitting the difference between mutual exclusive absolutes. We think that there's this, you know, difference there that we're hanging on to, and if we don't hang on to that, we'll fall into the abyss. But it's only seen as an abyss when we think there's something there which we call this splitting the difference. then we have a duality there, you see. Because if we think that there really is a splitting the difference, and we're holding on to something there, how do we account for the fact that there really isn't? Well, we say, well, that's the abyss, but the feeling of like, you know, I don't feel it's possible. We translate that into an abyss, with the confusion being what we believe is keeping us from falling into the abyss. But when we recognize there isn't any third splitting the difference at all, it's not there at all, then we recognize where we're at, which is we're the ones who's clearly recognizing, you know, it's either one or the other, and all we have to do is choose. And you know, and we're not seeing any abyss at all. We're not seeing a third option. There isn't any third option. And so since there isn't any third option, we don't see ourselves as clinging to something in an abyss. It just isn't there at all. This is why Jesus places such a great emphasis on reason and recognizing truth and lies can't both be true. It's essential to recognize this mutual exclusive absolutes. There's no splitting the difference between them. There's no middle ground. There's no difference between them. One is true and the other is not true. That's not a difference between them that can be split. That's a mutual exclusivity. That's an exclusivity. If truth is true, then lie, no lies are true at all. There's zero. What is there to split? There's nothing there to split, so you don't split it. You can't. So there's no abyss. There's no abyss. It's not like you split it into an abyss and into a little island there. Say, yeah, I was able to split the difference, and well, it's mostly an abyss, but there's this little island there that I'm clinging to. That's what we believe we're in the situation we're in now. But no, we say, no, realize, no, we didn't split it at all. There's nothing to split. So there's no island, and there's no abyss. That's a non-existent duality. It's just simply, I have to choose between one or the other, that's all. And only one can be true. They can't both be true. So if it's not lies aren't true, then truth is true. That's all. Your mind is very simple. So, as Lanchenpa points out, this matrix of spaciousness, that this motionless, simple, vast matrix of spaciousness, naturally disposed without effort or practice. This is true. It's not something else. Where everything is ornamentation of spaciousness and nothing else. Where everything is ornamentation of spaciousness and nothing else. So either this is true or it's not true. There's no issue for us to split the difference. There's no call for that whatsoever. So that's why we leave the intellect out. And it becomes a spiritual issue, not an intellectual issue. So the guru-ness within us is there. In my case, I've been trying to, you know, add to the weightiness through years and decades and decades and decades of getting the bell of remembrance rung over and over and over and over and over and over and over. Continuing on with that. How are we doing the video? Oh, okay, very good, very good. Almost up to the 150 mark. And I never know when this program's going to quit. You know, say computers, you never know when this sudden error, you know, error, non-imputed value or whatever, something, it stops. So I just, you know, keep going and count our blessings. So you might assert, yes, I am the guru. Yes, I am the threefoldness. I am the three-in-oneness. I am the aspirant. I am the path. I am the guru. I am the three-in-oneness. There's no question that many who view these videos have very weighty guru-ness in them. Absolutely. So the more we can recognize this, the better. The three-in-oneness. I am the aspirant, I am the path, and I am the guru. Three-in-one. And it's the guru who brings the aspirant to safety. The safety of truth. The safety of recognition. There is no abyss. There is no, and there's no island in the ocean of a vast ocean of abyss, like ocean. There's no island at all. There's no ocean at all. In order to believe there's an island, we automatically have to believe there's an ocean. That's the duality. We get trapped in between truth and lies. If we try to split the difference, we then believe that there is some island to inhabit. There's some difference to inhabit. That's our being, that's our dwelling place, that's our reality. But we have to account for also this feeling like, I can't find it, you know. So we have to imagine there's this vast abyss, but somewhere in this vast abyss, there's a tiny, tiny little island, and we're having a real hard time staying on that island because we can't find it really. So we think, well, I keep slipping off of it. You know, it's there, but it's always like slipping through my fingers. And so we're in this perpetual feeling like I'm slipping, like on that boat. I'm holding on to the edge of the boat, and I'm slipping off of it, I'm going to slip off into the abyss, you know. We're always feeling that way, actually. It's always feeling this way. This is a duality. It has to arise this way. It has to arise this way. And I'm seeing this now. Wow. So the guru pulls us in from that situation, that terrible torment we have. Again, splitting the difference means we believe there has to be some difference to split there. So there must be a dwelling place for us. So we believe we are dwelling there, and yet we feel also that we can't really find it, and we think, well, it must be super small, and therefore we say, well, it has to be big enough for us to dwell on it. So we say, well, therefore there must be this vast abyss that makes it so hard to find and makes it so small. Right, and then we seem to be slipping off of it, and the abyss just seems to be ready to engulf us at any moment, and we desperately use our cleverness to keep, you know, saying, no, I'm going to be okay. I can hold on. Wow, such is the mental travails that we go through, constantly going through. So thank your guru. Call out to your inner guru. The inner guru is there. The inner guru is weighty, and keep adding on to the weightiness of it. Keep adding on to the weightiness of it. Now maybe I didn't call out to the guru, inner guru, before because it wasn't weighty enough. Finally, I decided, hey, I've got to call out, and maybe now, you know, it's weighty enough with this understanding. Is that this a very weighty understanding? The recognition. This is extremely profound recognition. I mean, it's got everything in it, right? All the fear, the abyss, the confusion, the false resolution of trying to split the difference between mutual exclusive absolutes, and how that's impossible, and how when we try to do that, and the, you know, all of this is all become clarified now. Just that long jump of the just helped sort of bring it to mind, you know, bring it to mind. So, hey, wait a minute, you know, he's speaking on absolutes here. What is an absolute? Let's look at this. So your inner guru is getting weightier and weightier and weightier, and you need to have confidence in the inner guru will pull you to safety out of this dreadful ocean of samsara, as they call it. It's really the dreadful fear, dualistic fear of the abyss, based on your belief that there has to be a difference, so it must be somewhere. It's just obscured by the vastness of the abyss. You know, it seems to be swallowed up in it. And we say, no, it's here. It's just, but it seems that we seem to be engulfed in this vast abyss. This is the existential, however you want, I don't know what kind of a philosophical term you want to call it, but this is the fear, this is the dread, this is the anxiety that we have. This is what drives people into psychoses and split mind, mental illnesses of all types. It all derives from this. It all derives from this. And it's funny, I looked at that guru in my dream. It had shortish hair, normal clothes. I didn't look like a guru, you know, like a rishi It didn't seem that way at all. I said, you know, didn't look like the Bolanoth on the right here. See, there you know, that looks like, what does that look like? That looks like a guru, huh? The long hair, the beard, the twisted dreadlock type of thing, the white, you know, wrapped around the beads there. I mean, it's all there. It's all there. It's all there. Then the Anandamayama there, the guru there, is just a, you know, very simple white sari, and you know, you just, you know, it didn't in a jungle, you know, the background is the jungle of Himalayan jungle there. No, it was just like looked like a contemporary person, you know, with thick glasses. And I said, wow, that's an unusual looking guru. I didn't know gurus looked like that. I didn't know no gurus look like that. And I said, wait a minute, that kind of looks like me. Yeah, I said, that's not possible. How could that be possible? I'm not a guru. How could that be possible? Well, you know, maybe, you know, the weightiness is accumulating. And certainly this latest clarification in this video is really heavy. Really heavy. And to just be able to see this and be natural with it, you know, is really good news. Good news. Very good news. Good news for that one that's clinging, you know, for its life to the ship, afraid of falling into the abyss. It's very good news for that one. I was surprised. I mean, for this to clarify like this is astonishing. So again, if you're going through a crisis, and I wouldn't be surprised if many are going through a crisis right now, actually, because we realize, hey, if we don't get pulled to safety soon, you know, we're really going to be swallowed up by an incredibly disingenuous belief system, ideology of artificial intelligence. It's like what we're basically saying is, I can't find this island. I split the difference between mutually exclusive absolutes, and I know it's somewhere. There's this a huge abyss. It's so huge, I can't find it. Maybe it's this, maybe it's this. And then someone comes along and says, well, the problem is, you know, you just need this artificial intelligence, and that'll find it for you. That'll find the island for you. And you'll be stable. Once you'll find it for you, and you'll be able to be happy and stable on it, and your problems are solved. No, your problems are just buried under extreme delay. And the mental illness will arise, very severe mental illnesses will arise from this artificial intelligence. Many, many, many types of dissociation, and wow, it's really bad. And so we know this is coming. And like I say, in 15 months' time, maybe even less than that now. June 21st, 2016. What are we now? April, like 13th, right? So is it May, June, July, September, October, November, January, February, March, April, May, June? Holy cow. What is that? It's like 13 months? Wait a minute. It's like, wow. So May up to May is one. May, June, July, August, September, October, November, December, January, February, and then March, April, May, no, June, 14. June, 14 months, 14. Yeah, 14 months. I just want to make sure I don't get tricked on the counting April twice. So it's 14 months. Away from when artificial intelligence, where this will, this idea, this notion, this foolish, whimsical notion, this defense system, the world will embrace it. It's already embraced in many places in the world, but there's this 100-monkey syndrome where it crystallizes, as it were, and the resistance just collapses. At some point, you know, the camel's back, you put a straw on the camel's back, it collapses. And there's no more resistance. So the resistance will collapse. I see it collapsing very soon, actually. And so we're desperate. Those who want to be safely in the boat of sanity are quite desperate right now. But, must keep our poise. I almost lost my poise today. It's one of the worst I've experienced in a long time. I felt like breaking things, you know. I felt like breaking a golf club. Yeah, I just wanted to hit the concrete with it and just break it and just hit something. I was so frustrated because I said I'm just desperate and I don't have the answer. My gosh. But I kept working, had a lot of trouble. I was cursing. I was, because the computer wasn't working well, I was running into obstacle after obstacle after obstacle. But when I saw those glasses lying, I was going to break my golf club on some. I was going to start smashing everything, you know, smash the lights, smash the computer, smash everything. And I saw the glasses lying on the ground. It's almost sort of hidden. I said, hey, wait a minute. And I stopped. Let me put those glasses on. And I put them on. I looked at myself and I said, maybe I am the guru. And then as soon as I recognized maybe I am the guru, then I said, whoa. Let's calm things down here. Let's get to work here. Okay, so when you're in this crisis, something, stay attentive. Some miracle will happen. And you will recognize, hey, maybe I am the guru. You're speaking of yourself. You'll say, maybe I do have the answer. Let me calm down. Let me keep working on this weightiness. Let me keep working on this weightiness. So the inner guru, if you really want to symbolize it, would be this here on the right. This is a beautiful way of symbolizing the inner guru. this inner guru knows the truth. You know, you can just, I can just feel it, you know, that they are not the slightest bit confused or baffled by this so-called confusion, abyss, fear of the abyss, all of this. No. Monkchapa even says something about that. The you know, this crosses the abyss, crosses the fear of the abyss when you recognize this. So, and indeed he says that people who are, you know, confused, that their fear of liberation, they fear the abyss. The fear of the abyss is, you know, they feel like, oh, if I'm liberated from confusion, that's my island, that's my safety, and then I'll fall into this abyss, you see. So then they're not able to put it in the right context, so the fear is enormous. But we have within us this absolutely poised guru within us. This is, you might call this a super guru. And the super guru keeps telling us, add to your weightiness. You can be the guru. You can be the guru. You can be the guru. Come on. We'll help you a little bit. We'll help a little bit. But ultimately, we are the guru. The inner guru is us, is what we truly are. But we have to put it in the right context. We have to put it in the right context, which is what we are working on here. As we focus on spaciousness, that everything is ornamentation of spaciousness and nothing else. That everything is ornamentation of spaciousness and nothing else. That everything is ornamentation of spaciousness and nothing else. That everything is ornamentation of spaciousness and nothing else. But actually, we're working on the totality of the situation, aren't we? So don't string together a story out of this. Don't string together some linear story. Okay, this and this, 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 this. As for, you know, we're working on the overall situation here. Gaining weight, gaining weight, gaining weight. Becoming very weighty. Becoming very weighty. Mm-hmm. Becoming very weighty. 1 minute. Yeah.
Okay.
How are we doing here? Okay. I guess it's getting somewhat time for dinner. do we have time for dinner? I don't know. That's one way to get weighty. And I was actually eating a lot because I felt this need to get weighty and weighty and weighty. Where's the cake? Where's the ice cream? You know, let me eat, get heavy, heavy, heavy. I need to be heavier, heavier. I'm not heavy enough. And there's this fear, like, I just got to get heavier. So this clarification about mutual exclusive absolutes and how the ego counsels splitting the difference, as if you can have your cake and eat it too. You can have both reality as perfect and reality as flawed. And we don't have to drop our idea of being greater than God, because, you know, it's a way of clinging to it. It's really an expression of continuity fear. Our continuity fear leads us to make this ridiculous belief we can split the difference between mutually exclusive absolutes. And then this leads to this terrible fear of an island of confusion in a vast abyss. And this slipping off of it, we never quite have it. You know, where is it? I think I have it here, but it, you know, it's like slipping out of our hands. We can't quite grasp it. Never can grasp the confusion properly. Oscillating between the mutual exclusives to make believe we can't understand either one. And that, and this is then the third option, which is really just confusion. All of this is heavy, heavy weightiness. Heavy, heavy weightiness. So as you hear this and get used to it, you're putting on a tremendous amount of spiritual weight. So it's the spiritual weight you want to put on. So it's not hopeless. It's not hopeless at all for anyone, actually. But in this day and age, you're going to go one direction or the other. I mean, you're going to go to artificial intelligence believing, okay, you know, this is the answer. You know, as they're telling us constantly throughout the world now, the message that the drums are beating for artificial intelligence, robotics, artificial intelligence is permeating our society already. It's already vastly permeating our society. And we're told, look how much free time you'll have to do with what you really want. You'll be able to do what you really want in this wonderful island of confusion we think that we're on. And really, we're just frantically clinging, and that frantic clinging continues. But we desperately try to make it seem like, well, there's a drug will take care of that. Don't worry. There's a drug will take care of that. And then these drugs have more problems, but more drugs can take care of that. And, you know, genetic snipping should take care of it. And get the robots helping you out, and that should make you feel better. And, you know, like that, on and on and on and on and on. So, of course, we're feeling the pressure of these times, right? Absolutely. But that's a good for us to get going here and to increase our weightiness. So I have to avoid pigging out and gaining massive amounts of weight physically. That's not the answer. All right. Very great. Let's get this up and available to you, because this is a breakthrough video. This is big time breakthrough video.